Welcome, Sunrise family. Those that are gathered here, those that are worshiping with us in our online campus. My name is Amy and I am one of the pastors. You know, someone asked me this past week on social media, when's your church opening up? And I told them the same thing that I've been telling people for this whole time, is our church actually never closed, because the church, the Greek New Testament word for church is ekklesia, which is a called out people. The church is a people, it's not a building, and our church has sprung to life in ways for mission and ministry in our community, and also worship. Now, you have to maybe work a little harder or be a little more intentional about worship, but we have had small gatherings in homes, worship circles, about four of them that have been gathering for months now. Many of you gather with family and neighbors, and there are now formal opportunities for that called out gathering to meet both in the building and as well as other opportunities. And you can see those when you go to www.sunrisefamily.org/RSVP, both for weekend worship and a Thursday night tapings, and then also for youth and children programming. There are some new in-person gatherings that are happening, so you'll want to check all of those out and make sure that during this time that your faith is still something that you're prioritizing and being intentional about. And so we also invite you to share this worship experience if you're worshiping with us online, specifically on Facebook. Go ahead and go to that share arrow and click on it so that you're in essence inviting all of your friends and family to worship along with you as well. And if you are worshiping by yourself or with a family or with a worship circle or small group, no matter how you're worshiping, we invite you to let us know that you're here with us by texting your attendance in to the number that you see below. Text us your names, and if you've never texted that number before and you want to let us know, hey, I'm here too, I'm worshiping too, text the word connect to that number so that we can begin the journey of connecting together and being part of a faith community together. I invite you to pray with me. Thank you, God, for your presence in this place. Thank you for the people that you surround us with that are also your followers, that can guide us and help us and encourage us in our faith journeys as well. Be blessed by our worship of you over the next few minutes. In Jesus' name, amen. And in addition to worship, there are opportunities for discipleship at Sunrise and different ways to connect. And so I want to share a few of those with you now. First of all, it's October, which at Sunrise means that is the month of prayer, where we want to fill every single hour with prayers being lifted up on behalf of our hurting world, our community, our family, relationships, and churches all over the world. Sign up today and pray in the comfort of your own home. We'll be trying to fill up every hour in October with our prayers. That's 24 hours a day, 7 days a week throughout the month of October. Sign up on the website link you see on the screen. Also, our next drive-through communion and prayer is coming up on Sunday, October 11th from 12:30 to 2 with our pastors. As always, please enter through the McClure Road parking lot. If you reside out of town or are unable to come to the building in O'Fallon, Missouri, you can partake at home. Please visit the website you see on the screen to fill out the form so that we can get your communion elements to you and be able to give those that way. You do not have to register if you are participating in the drive-thru at church. Next, there are two opportunities that are Stage 1 Discipleship at Sunrise growth opportunities, both starting in October. And the first is on Sunday, October 11th at 9:30 a.m., a brand new in-person weekly Alpha class begins. Alpha is a chance to explore the meaning of life and a way to investigate a different question around faith and create conversation no matter where you may be in your own faith walk. You can sign up on the web address you see on the screen. Also, new member class will be hosted on Zoom on October 17th. It's a Saturday, and it's a great way to learn more about Sunrise and consider becoming part of a supportive church family. Again, you can sign up for that on the web address that you see there for you on the screen. And at this time, I invite us all to sing and worship our great God together.
Blessed Redeemer, this
Rather disorienting kind of day. And when I think about it, I've had a rather disorienting kind of week. And for me, the only real solution to that is to come back to Jesus and be in the presence of God, because in the presence of God, I find peace and I find calm. And I find a quiet confidence that I really can't get anywhere else. And so as we pray today, I invite you to repeat, "Come, Lord Jesus, come." Can you just say that with me now? Come, Lord Jesus, come. Let's pray together. Lord, we keep coming back to you, to the one who is our anchor for our souls, to the one who is our rock, to the one who is our shepherd, who leads us and guides us and protects us and cares for us and restores our souls. And Lord, in this time of this political season that we're in, that can be rather chaotic and feel concerning and a bit disorienting, Lord, we pray that in each and every heart, we pray together and say, "Come, Lord Jesus, come." Lord, even in our own church family here at Sunrise, in the shadow of our mailboxes and beyond, Lord, I think of so many of our family members who are hurting, who are sick, who faced bad news and diagnoses they didn't want to hear this past week, who are grieving, who are trying to keep their lives going, and they are concerned about so many real challenges they are facing. And in each and every one of their homes and lives and hearts, we pray together and say, "Come, Lord Jesus, come." Lord, we're so grateful for all that you have done for us and all you continue to do for us, and for how you call us to be better than we are, better than we can be on our own, Lord. But sometimes we get to the end of the day and we realize we've failed. We've not said something we should have said, or we've said something we shouldn't have said, or God, we just missed the mark. And we ask for your forgiveness to pour over us. And we pray together and say, come, Lord Jesus, come. And we pray together the prayer you taught your disciples. And we say together, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. As I mentioned earlier, there's just been a lot of feet on the ground, delivering food, working together, serving this local chapter of God's kingdom that's working to bring God's kingdom mission and ministry here on this earth. And it takes all of us. And so there are different ways that you can give to support the mission and ministry and work of God here at Sunrise, and they're on your screen for you now. You can text to give. That's probably the easiest and most convenient. You text the amount that you choose to give to that number that you see on the screen. You can also go to our website, where there are secure places to enter the information you want to be able to give there. And finally, you can also still mail a check to the physical address here at the O'Fallon campus. And you know what, Pastor Jim, really being a part of a faith community, it's just like one gigantic group effort.
It is all of us working together.
All of us working together. And this is an exciting day because we are going to give everyone an opportunity after the teaching time. We have a set aside few minutes to invite you all to go to the commitment card. It's a virtual commitment card at sunrisefamily.org/commitment. And there you can see all of the things that we're inviting you to do for 2021. And it includes prayers, and it includes service, and it includes discipleship, and it includes giving. And so after the teaching time, we invite you to do that. And we're gonna like all kind of do a group effort together. And what's really cool, I think, is that our graphic artists, we're gonna make it a little more fun, and they created something for us. So can you show us what that thing that they created is? So I was looking at this. Can you help me figure this out, Pastor Jim? I see a bunch of things. What are all those things?
What I see are a bunch of doors. Kind of reminds me of the movie with all the doors in it. And always there's something behind doors, isn't there?
Oh, look, it's a big giant key. What's that key doing?
Well, I bet if I had a key, I would use it to unlock a door.
Oh my gosh, Jim, you are so smart. Look, there it goes. It's unlocking a door. Okay, well, what do you think that means to unlock?
That's a great question, what it means when it unlocks a door. I believe that those doors represent us who are part of Sunrise. And every time someone completes a commitment card, one of those doors are opened.
That is very exciting. That's a lot of doors.
That's a lot of doors.
It's gonna take a lot of us filling out our commitment cards.
There's a lot of us.
There is, yes. And it looks like there's something behind that door when it opened. What's behind that door?
Well, you know what? We won't know what's back there till everyone has turned in their commitment cards, so that we can see the great reveal, so to speak, of what's back there.
Well, thanks for explaining that to me, Pastor Jim.
Great idea. I love that. Hey, before we get started on this week's installment of Discipleship at Sunrise, friends, I want to take a moment for a word of discernment coming from me to you. So if you hear nothing else in the next 2.5 minutes, this is where you need to set down all distractions, kind of get close to whatever you are worshiping on, and just be with me for this. I did some calculation the other day, and this is, for me at Sunrise, now entering my 5th presidential election, beginning all the way back in 2004. And I want to kind of take a moment of reminder. First, let me say that while I encourage passion and participation in and for politics, I want to remind you, friends, that Sunrise needs to be a place that is safe and a neutral place for all of us to gather and to get away from all that is happening out in the world so that we can then work together to populate the kingdom of heaven. So when you're at Sunrise, you are representing Sunrise out in the world. And when we do, friends, let me remind you that when we are Sunrise out in the world, we are neither Democrat nor are we Republican. We are not defined by a party platform or a hot topic issue. Instead, we are Christians who follow Jesus and are on a collective mission from God. In fact, Ecclesiastes 4, which, by the way, is this weekend's family ministry video, so you can find out more about it, speaks of the importance of individuals coming together and working together to utilize our different gifts and talents to achieve our goal here at Sunrise of populating the kingdom of heaven. For example, just in this year, yes, this year, this bizarre, unusual, unprecedented, unpredictable year, at Sunrise, with every one of us pulling together, we have done some amazing things. First, I just want to share with you, we have collected and distributed 1,000 bags plus of groceries. Now, I come through the church kitchen a couple times a week, and that counter in there, that bar, is packed with grocery bags filled with groceries. And the other day, I just picked one up out of curiosity, and they weigh about 10 pounds each. So my math tells me we have done over 10,000 pounds of groceries that have gone out to homes. Plus, we have bulk supplied all of the Fort Zumwalt School District, the Wright City Middle School and High School, the Lift for Life Charter School in St. Louis, as well as Francis Howell High School. Secondly, we have dispersed $12,000 plus in neighbor helping neighbor support. In addition to that, there have been countless hours of volunteers in collaboration and consulting and counseling with our clients. Third, we have received over $700,000 of your generosity given specifically to support ministry mission and operational budget in 2020. Friends, let me tell you, this is not Republican giving. This is not Democrat giving. This is not Green Party or Independent Party giving. This is the dedicated following of a group of Christians setting aside perceived differences to work together to make a significant impact and difference in people's lives and to ultimately fulfill our mission of populating the kingdom of heaven. So friends, over the next month, I would encourage you that when we gather as Sunrise in building, online, anywhere off campus, in meetings, in Bible studies, even if we are wearing our Sunrise gear out in public, we have, because of any of those, made a first choice to represent the kingdom of heaven. And as such, that expectation is that we are at that moment setting our political passions and conversations aside to do kingdom work. Now, let me say, when not representing Sunrise, please don't ever lose your political passion or your participation. Yet I still encourage you to display it in a respectful and a healthy way that still brings honor and glory to God through our conversations, our voice, and our social media postings. Because friends, in reality, we never stop being a follower of Jesus. There is no off button. So we good? If you'd like to further discuss with me or have conversation, send me an email, call me on the phone, send me a text, and we'll continue talking. But I just strive for folks to know that when they are part of Sunrise, they are in a healthy and safe environment to do God's work. Well, what a great segue to this week's Discipleship at Sunrise teaching, which, by the way, is also, as you've heard before, our Sunrise 2021 Commitment Series. Now, commitment in the life of the church family can bring up all kinds of thoughts and emotions, from excitement and jubilation at the opportunity to be faithful and faith-filled and fruitful to be honest, concerns based on uncertainties of availability, ability, and resources. It runs the gamut. As United Methodist people, we make a commitment in our membership vows that includes supporting Sunrise with our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness. I'd like you to say that with me. Prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness. Five things. And each year, we are challenged to review, to reassess, and to recommit for the coming year. Now, our definition of a disciple sums up this commitment thought precisely. Remember what it was we've shared it the last couple weeks. Here it is again. A disciple is someone who, through God's grace, accepts Jesus Christ into their heart and commits, hear that word, commits to follow his teachings. Friends, every year since I became a member of the United Methodist Church way back in 1979, it sure seems that one area that is often pressed on now from my side, and at the same time perplexing from your side, is the area of generosity. Yes, there is more behind-the-scenes discussions about money than any other of the commitment areas. Yes, some folks think that we talk way too much about giving. And there are others that wish we talked more about generosity. Can't win for lose. And yes, it does take money to make ministry happen. And we recognize that it takes money to keep your life in balance. And yes, at times it seems there is a competition for those same limited resources each of us have at our disposal. So friends, I wanted to know, not what I think, not what I say, but what does the Bible say about generosity? And I found a unique, interesting, and I think informative passage of Scripture that as believers speaks to each of us, no matter where we may find ourselves on the generosity spectrum. So I'm going to have you turn in the New Testament to the book of 2 Corinthians, and we're going to be in the 8th chapter. In Paul's second letter to the believers in this Greek city of Corinth, he talks about how we should respond to commitment as faith-filled disciples and to generosity in particular. Now, to set the stage, Paul is writing about a collection that is underway throughout all of the Christian communities and churches and home-based churches in the Roman Empire. A collection to assist the believers back in Jerusalem where the movement started. Hard economic times had settled into Jerusalem, and even harder times were the reality for the Jewish Christians who were there in Jerusalem, who had been shunned by their non-Jesus-believing family and neighbors. A need was discovered, and an opportunity to help was initiated. Friends, no regard was given to anyone being either Jew or Gentile in the assessment of this need. So let's look at what Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, beginning with verse number 1. Paul says, "Now I want you to know, dear brothers and sisters, what God in his kindness has done through the churches in Macedonia." So a couple things to note. When Paul mentions Macedonia, he's talking about an area that is in extreme northern Greece. Corinth is in the southern part of Greece, and so about 500 miles away are Christian communities that are Philippi and Thessalonica and Berea. Paul is writing about them. You notice that Paul opens this chapter and this assessment of generosity and commitment with an example of what others have done and not a hard-handed plea for giving. Verse number 2. "They are being tested by many troubles, and they are very poor, but they are also filled with abundant joy, which has overflowed in rich generosity. Friends, their poverty no more impeded their generosity than their trials diminished their joy. Boy, isn't that a great church? I'd love to pastor that church, that they didn't let things get in the way. The things of the world didn't bother them. They gave from the rich grace of God to people they had never met before. They were fellow Christians who simply had a need. Verse 3. For I can testify that they gave not only what they could afford, but far more, and they did it of their own free will. Verse 4, they begged us again and again for the privilege of sharing in the gift for the believers in Jerusalem. Verse 5, they even did more than we had hoped, for their first action was to give themselves to the Lord and to us, just as God wanted them to do. You see, discipleship, true discipleship growth produces a generous spirit. And that's what the churches in Macedonia were doing. They were doing it in order. They were developing their discipleship. They were growing deeper in their faith and commitment. And out of that poured a generous spirit. Verse number 6. So we have urged Titus, who encouraged your giving in the first place, to return to you and encourage you to finish this ministry of giving. Verse 7, since you excel in so many ways, in your faith, your gifted speakers, your knowledge, your enthusiasm, and your love from us, I want you to excel also in this gracious act of giving. You see, generosity is an act of discipleship that comes through God's grace that has been given to us. It is an outpouring of thanksgiving for what God has done for us through Jesus. Verse 8, I am not commanding you to do this, but I am testing how genuine your love is by comparing it with the eagerness of the other churches. Verse 9, you know the generous grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that by his poverty you could be rich. Verse 10, here is my advice. It would be good for you to finish what you started a year ago. Last year, you were the first who wanted to give, and you were the first to begin doing it. Verse 11, now you should finish what you started. Let the eagerness you showed in the beginning be matched by your giving. Giving in proportion to what you have. Friends, I'm not sure what happened in the city of Corinth in that church over that year. I don't know why they lost their focus or the initiative to fulfill that commitment was forgotten. But a reminder and a strong commitment to follow through was needed to match their initial great intentions to help the Jerusalem believers. As I read that, I couldn't help but think about membership vows and the intentions that we have when we start off strong as a new member of prayers, presence, gifts, service, witness. We're excited to be part of such a powerful and great movement of God in this place. And over time, that excitement can lose its luster and we forget that first love that we had. Verse 12 says this, whatever you give is acceptable if you give it eagerly. And give according to what you have, not what you don't have. We need to understand that eagerly can also be enthusiastically or willingly, and that we are to give in the proportion of what we can do. We shouldn't overdo. In fact, Paul goes on to say in verse number 13, of course, I don't mean your giving should make life easy for others and hard for yourselves. I only mean that there should be some equity, some equality. In other words, we need to have a strategic plan. We need to assess, not give out of emotion, but give out of our willingness. Verse 14, right now you have plenty and can help those who are in need. Later they will have plenty and can share with you when we need it. In this way, things will be equal. I am blessed that on this year's commitment card, and I give all props to Pastor Amy for this idea, that instead of just ask, that every one of our areas, there is an opportunity for a person that may have need to say, you know, I would love to be able to be generous, but right now my financial situation is such that I could really use some assistance. Friends, if that's you, if you are looking at that commitment card and just kind of lost because you feel that you can't participate, then read this verse, that there is a time when we can give and there's also a time that we can receive. Verse 15 says this, as the scriptures say, those who gather a lot had nothing left over, and those who gathered only a little had enough. Paul's referring to the story in Exodus 16, the gathering of the daily manna that God provided. And as you read that in Exodus 16, neither was there a surplus from those who gathered a lot, nor a deficiency in those who gathered little. But everything came out in equality. Sharing what we have, what God has blessed us with, is the foundation of God's grace for the Christian life. I've seen that in action. Many years ago when we were serving at the church in Gravois Mills, we had a lot of young families in our church that were seasonal workers. The season there at the Lake of the Ozarks, you know, the strong season ran from May through September. And folks, you know, made a lot of money at that time. And then the off season, beginning in September and ending in April, was a tough time for lots of folks. And so we would do a kind of a Christmas in July food drive. And we'd have folks bring in non-perishable goods, and we would store those at the church. And when the off season came at the lake, we would have, you know, opportunity to bless people. And I remember this one Sunday during our Christmas in July food drive that this couple came in with their four little kids, and they were seasonal workers. And mom and dad both had both arms full of sacks of groceries, and the kids were carrying what they kind of dragging what they could. And I kind of looked at him. He said, and he knew that I had this puzzled look on my face because they were one of our regular recipients during the off season. And I remember Terry saying to me, he said, Pastor, he says, we're bringing this in because this is our season of blessing and we have it. And we just want you to hold on to it for when we in our season of shortage in the wintertime. We know that it's in good hands and it's going to be here. You see, that's what Paul's talking about. There is a time for us to give. There may be a time for us to receive. And both is okay. Friends, I will admit that I would be the first to say that following the teachings of Jesus or any scripture is easier said than done. I can be pretty good at vocalizing my intentions, but follow through is kind of something that I struggle with at times. A.W. Tozer was a gifted pastor and a highly respected 20th century theologian who passed away in 1963. But in a book that has just been released based on a lifetime of his sermons, it's called A Cloud by Day, A Fire by Night, Finding and Following God's Will for Your Life. There is this powerful quote, "Our victory in the Christian experience rests upon obedience." I can't stress too much how important it is to obey God. In order to obey God fully, he says, we need to be saturated in the Word of God under the leadership of the Holy Spirit. If I can challenge you in anything right now, especially during this month of prayer and an hour alone with God, is to saturate yourself in the Word of God, being led by the power of the Holy Spirit. You see, friends, a scripturally grounded life of obedience takes our initial intentions, our good intentions, and moves us, nudges us, sometimes kicks us toward full completion. Our personal discipleship is a lifelong lifestyle. It's a lifelong journey that strives to obey God and grow deeper in our faith each and every day. Friends, I'm a firm believer from my own personal experiences as well as my professional experience that all the struggles, the woes, the conflicts, and the challenges found within the life of the church, name whatever it may be. In fact, that might be a great discussion question for your worship circle or your small group or wherever you're gathered. Name some of the woes or challenges or struggles or conflicts that you may have witnessed in the life of the church. And when you name those, I will tell you this, all of them come down to personal discipleship growth, or really lack thereof. The more we intentionally seek to grow in our spiritual maturity, the more we become obedient-centered, the more our discipleship life becomes a lifestyle, the more often many of those church issues disappear and never reappear. The scripture encourages us to move forward with what we have started and to focus on following through with our first commitment intentions. As a disciple, how will Sunrise 2021 be blessed and shaped by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? Let's pray. God, as we come here, I give you thanks for this awesome opportunity just to be saturated in Scripture, to let your Holy Spirit lead us in the understanding of what was written to Christians over 2,000 years ago that is relevant and powerful and necessary for us today. Lord, as we worship, as we receive, may you fill our spirits so that we may find an opportunity to be generous, not just with our money, but generous with our time and our talents and our gifts. And that as we work together to populate your kingdom of heaven. We pray that in your name. Amen. Friends, the great thing about being a follower of Christ, that we are inheritors of the kingdom of heaven. God has blown into us the very breath of life. The ruah becomes who we are. We have God's breath that is in us and that comes out of us. So let's worship God, the breath of life.
let your wind blow. Oh, let your fire fall. Your fire fall. Let your wind blow. Let your fire fall. Let your wind blow. Let your fire fall.
Friends, my prayer is that you have experienced the power of God, the breath of God, falling upon you as a follower and believer in Jesus. My prayer is, if you haven't, that maybe today is a day that God has carved in stone for you to say yes, to become a follower, to begin moving in the direction of giving your all to follow Jesus, to be obedient. Friends, as we have opportunity, if you did not take it during that song, I would encourage you to be sure and go to the commitment website, fill that out, pray over every one of those opportunities and options. And if you're not a tech person and say, I'm just not sure how to do it, if you would like a paper copy, just contact our office and we'll get one to you. So I have a question for you this week. Can't let you leave without one. And it's very simply this. How will you follow through with your first intention to bless others through your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? Friends, remember a family ministry video in Ecclesiastes 4 and the importance of how we, taking different times, talents, and gifts, putting them together, can populate the kingdom of heaven. Now receive God's blessings as we prepare for that wonderful message from Ecclesiastes 4. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us. Let that breath be that brings us power and grace, and that we would serve you with a great joy in our heart no matter what is happening in our life. We lean into you for strength and for peace. In Jesus' name, amen.
The Bible, it's 66 books of history, stories, letters, and poetry that fit together to form God's one big story. The epic adventure of how he created us and loves us so much that he made a way to rescue us. As we travel through the Bible, from Genesis to Revelation, we discover people who met God and found their lives changed forever. Now, for an amazing story, inspired by the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 4, verses 9 through 12.
The writer of Ecclesiastes tells us two people are better than one. They can help each other in everything they do. Suppose either of them falls down, then the one can help the other one up. But suppose a person falls down and doesn't have anyone to help them up. Then feel sorry for that person. One person could be overpowered, but two people can stand up for themselves. And a rope made with three cords isn't easily broken. Let's see how this might play out in someone's life today. Jackson slid into the small school theater and took a seat in the back row and waited for Mr. Ray, the music and arts teacher. It looked like there was only one other kid who showed up to build the set for the fifth grade production of Charlotte's Web, Amal from Mrs. Wiseman's class.
Hey.
Hi.
The two boys sat there in awkward silence until Mr. Ray showed up.
Ah, my set team. Fantastic. You guys know each other?
Kinda.
Different classes.
Well, you're gonna get to spend a lot of time together in the next 2 weeks as we build this set and get it painted. You guys got any experience with power tools?
Jackson could see Amal shift nervously in his seat.
No, I don't want to go on stage. Miss Wiseman said I could do this instead.
Don't worry, I'll teach you what you need to know. How about you, Jackson?
I'm pretty good with a hammer, and I didn't want to wear some silly animal costume.
The two boys basically ignored each other as Mr. Ray showed them how to measure each piece of lumber for him to cut, and then he helped them lay out the pieces in a large frame.
Now, this'll be one of the wall flats for the backdrop. We'll paint it as part of the barn. Amal, you want a hammer in these nails?
I guess.
Hold it more like this. Don't worry, you'll get it.
I'll do this side.
Jackson nailed together the entire flat while Amal still struggled with one corner.
What a klutz.
But it was a different story the next day when they started to paint.
This flat is part of our barn wall. I want you guys to paint a couple of chickens right there.
Amal grabbed a brush right away.
Oh, do you want them to look like real chickens or like cartoons?
Nah, just give them your own personal spin.
Amal got to work right away creating an entire palette of colors while Jackson was still trying to figure out which brush to pick.
Now, I've got to run down to the art room. Amal, why don't you show Jackson how to get started?
I don't really...
Mr. Ray smiled at them both.
He needs a hand. I think you guys will make a great team.
Mr. Ray hurried out. Jackson and Amal avoided each other's eyes.
I'll sketch an outline for the chickens.
What do I do?
Just, you know, fill it in.
I'm not really an artist.
Jackson dipped his brush randomly in the blue paint and frowned at Amal's outline.
Just have fun with it.
Jackson swiped the blue brush, outlining a wing.
I've never seen a blue chicken.
Oh.
It's great. It'll stand out.
Oh. Thanks.
By the time Mr. Ray returned, Jackson was surprised to discover that he and Amal had already painted 5 brilliant hued chickens. Mr. Ray grinned.
I've never seen a more flamboyant flock.
Jackson held out his fist to Amal, and Amal, surprised, gave him a fist bump.
Yep, see you boys tomorrow.
The next day, Amal showed up with a bruised finger on his left hand.
I can still paint with my right.
What happened?
Mr. Kunkel keeps putting me in as goalie during PE, and then I mess it up, and everyone on the team gets mad at me.
Do you stay on your toes? Keep your eye on the ball?
No. I just panic when the ball comes at me.
Look, I can show you some tips later in the parking lot, before my mom comes.
Really? That would be great.
And you know, Jackson turned out to be a pretty good teacher because Amal managed to get 2 blocks during PE the next day. And when Jackson showed up to paint sets, stressed out by a math test, Amal grabbed his textbook.
Fractions?
I see all these weird numbers and I freeze up.
You just have to break it down like this.
With Amal's help, Jackson managed to stay calm during his test the next day. And by the middle of the next week, they had completed the entire backdrop for Charlotte's Web.
Well done. I knew you two would make a great team.
Amal's pretty okay.
Jackson's not too terrible.
Look, I know you guys are really different from each other, but it's boring if all your friends are just like you.
Together, they started gathering wood scraps and wiping off brushes.
Seriously, one of the wisest men to ever live pointed this out. Solomon.
Solomon?
Yep. He's this king in the Bible. He was a builder and an artist and super rich too. But for all the things he had, you know what he valued most? Friendship. He says it like this. 2 people are better than 1. They can help each other in everything they do.
On point.
Yeah.
Amal held out his fist and Jackson tapped it with his own. Maybe Solomon and Mr. Ray were onto something.